Welcome, everybody. Welcome back. If you're joining us for this six-part series on the psychology of chronic illness, Making It Normal, brought to you by the Bateman Horne Center and myself, Timothy Wyman. I'm a licensed clinical social worker providing counseling services through telecounseling through Utah and Arizona residents. I'm also a member of the chronic illness community, which has facilitated my connection to the Bateman Horne Center. Now, what we're doing here is we're doing this six-part series on what is normal for people to experience when they're facing chronic illness. I find through my own personal experience and working with other people that there's barriers in that being communicated to people. And so the aim of these presentations is to bridge that gap, that hopefully you will find some value in this, and it can maybe help with any kind of disorientation, confusion, or lack of knowledge that you might have about the illness experience. So through this series, I'm drawing on multiple research articles and books related to chronic illness. You can find them in the references. Because it's generally chronic illness, it's not always ME, CFS, or fibromyalgia specific. However, the research that I reference does include ME, CFS, fibromyalgia, as well as cancer, hepatitis, heart failure, autoimmune dysfunction, and pretty much everything else. Today, so it is a six-part series, as previously said. The first part, if you joined us, was on development in the phases of chronic illness. Today, or in this presentation, we're talking about anxiety. Then we will later talk about depression, identity, relationships, and meaning-making, religion, and spirituality as it relates to being chronically ill. So let's dig right in and look at anxiety. So I think it would be good first to kind of review the symptoms of anxiety in case you're unaware. I provide these as indicators that if you identify with any of these, you could maybe say, you know, maybe I should be further assessed for the presence of an anxiety disorder. Now, some of these common symptoms associated with anxiety can be that fall under the psychological category. So in our minds, can be obsessions. So these are disturbing and are repetitive thoughts that we can't seem to get out of our mind. Maybe you find yourself obsessively thinking about, you know, what's the future going to be like for your disease or disorders, or maybe you're ruminating about the past. So this is about, you know, when you were not experiencing these symptoms that you're currently experiencing. Secondary, we can have replaying memories of embarrassment, humiliation, or losses or difficulties. So perhaps you are revisiting moments that you felt embarrassed that, you know, you fell over or something due to your disease, or just generally losing certain functioning. Maybe you were in a conversation and you had fibro fog and you got really embarrassed at, you know, how you came across socially, things of that nature. We can also experience a mental preoccupation with concerns related to safety, a mental focus on a self that is flawed, vulnerable, or incapable. Mental rehearsals of possible future difficulties or encounters, and a belief or beliefs that others have it more together than you do. Emotional symptoms that we can find when anxiety is occurring are irritability and agitation, just generally feeling, you know, as people can say, keyed up or on edge, difficulty relaxing, struggling to access a sense of calmness, peace, or tranquility. It can even result into intense feelings of fear of impending doom, feeling just out of control. Secondary to that, feeling shame that you feel out of control or afraid. Having an early startle response. And because of all this keyed up nervous system going on, it can end up in exhaustion. Behavioral symptoms. The ways of anxiety going on can include reduction in the frequency and intensity of activities you once found pleasurable. We call this in psychology anhedonia, or no pleasure. Increased use of substances or other self-soothing and compulsive behaviors. Maybe you're binge eating, maybe your sexual activities got out of control, or your spending. You know, these are things that can give people this dopamine rushes that they try to use to soothe their nervous system. Engagement in general compulsions, maybe you're checking things or you become preoccupied with orderliness or rigidity or things being just a certain way. Frequently finding yourself checking out during the day due to overwhelm. maybe you're around certain people and you're kind of disassociating and you get a blank stare and you lose track of the conversation or things of that nature. This can include increased time spent housebound or bedbound, not attributed to your any other physical illness, but just because you're just so overwhelmed with the anxiety of perhaps going out. Disturbance in natural patterns, you know, you can see disruption in eating and sleeping. Disturbance in sleep related to that, difficulty falling asleep, staying asleep, going back to sleep, as well as high avoidance. In terms of relational symptoms, so how our relationships are when we're experiencing anxiety, we can have, as we touched on previously, social withdrawal and isolation. You may find yourself getting into more frequent arguments with family, friends, or coworkers. Feeling generally disconnected from others, increased fear of others, or of others finding out about how overwhelmed you get. General rigidity and inflexibility in negotiation with others, engaging in controlling behaviors and communication, or if socially anxious, sometimes we actually see the exact polar opposite, where you're maybe too accommodating to others out of fear of their judgment or potential discrimination, withdrawal, or abandonment. So it can be kind of a polarized, either you can be really super rigid and controlling or super too accommodating. And sometimes depending on the people, maybe both are happening. Okay, so anxiety becomes such a huge issue related to chronic illness because the purpose of fear is to face, from an evolutionary perspective, it's for us to face a potential threat. So our body prepares us to, if something's uncertain, our body prepares us for the worst case scenario. That's how our ancestors survived from an evolutionary perspective. The ones who were sensed the danger and reacted the fastest were the ones that got out of the way of the harm and lived to reproduce. And so uncertainty is there to, when it occurs, our bodies reignite this process. And maybe it worked well, you know, when our ancestors were foraging and facing crocodiles and tigers and bears and, you know, that kind of stuff. But it doesn't work as well when we have a chronic health condition that's continually ambiguous, such as what many people face with ME, CFS, and fibromyalgia. So living in fear and a loss of control become really huge things in terms of chronic illness. One author put it this way. He stated, in responding to chronic illness, individuals constantly test the meanings attached to their altered situation against the new reality of everyday experience. As you can see in the second point down here, the chronically ill are often worried and anxious about how and when their bodies will fail them. In a 2010 study, researchers reviewed studies of individuals struggling with congestive heart failure and found a common impact of everyday life, which included living in fear and a loss of control. Additionally, 20 male participants who were educated, married, and white and experiencing heart issues demonstrated that uncertainty did not change significantly over time. And in another study related to uncertainty, three groups of adolescents experiencing cancer at different lengths of time had concerns that changed throughout the term of the disease, but the uncertainty remained constant. So the topic, what they were uncertain about, would change, but no matter what, there was some uncertainty with any new topic that they were managing and dealing with. Additionally, anxiety can be triggered by experience of distress and displayed from others. A chronic illness that is invisible to others, or an illness that lacks specific diagnostic parameters, such as ME, CFS, and fibromyalgia, can increase our sense of anxiety because, again, the uncertainty goes up. The uncertainty we're experiencing and other people are experiencing with us. In one study of ME, CFS participants, they had higher levels of anxiety than both healthy controls, so peers who were healthy, as well as other people with chronic, different kinds of chronic illnesses. So generally in this last point, uncertainty really becomes the norm. If we look here on the right, we can see the consequences that are related to uncertainty. In one study of 50 women with fibromyalgia, women with higher pain levels and high illness uncertainty had more difficulty coping with their disease, and levels of uncertainty have shown to diminish levels of adjustment. Which makes sense from an intuitive perspective, right? If you don't, the more you don't know what's going on, you don't really know how to respond to it. Additionally, in the 2006 study related to fibromyalgia, uncertainty significantly, quote, impacted the partner relationships of patients with fibromyalgia. So the more uncertainty that was there, the more negative impact in the romantic relationships of these fibromyalgia participants. In a 2009 study of hepatitis C patients, quote, ambiguity was identified as a primary construct of illness uncertainty and has the strongest relationship with depressive symptoms, quality of life, and fatigue. So we can also see with uncertainty an increase in depressive symptoms, a decrease in quality of life, and an increase in fatigue. Higher levels of uncertainty are associated with diminished mood and general quality of life in persons with chronic illness as a finding as well in the research related to all of this. So how do we cope with all this? Knowing that it's here, knowing that it has very real consequences, we look at some of the coping solutions that have shown to work through research. The first point here we have is that we have to relate differently to uncertainty. People typically try to eliminate their uncertainty. When you're chronically ill, we're managing uncertainty. So it becomes not about getting rid of the uncertainty. Where we can, we do. But it's also about how do we manage it? How are we relating to it? As a sub point, underneath this, we look at flexibility to changing circumstances. So we want to work on becoming as flexible as possible if you're already not a flexible person. This is where things like Buddhist psychology and acceptance and commitment therapy can come in. Acceptance and commitment therapy is a form of what's known as Buddhist psychology. Buddhist psychology is psychological researchers took elements of a wisdom tradition, Buddhism, that is thousands of years old and have tested different aspects of it and have shown different positive effects of some of these principles and practices. A big one is mindfulness, and you'll see that meditation and mindfulness, Bateman Horne Center recently did a presentation on that, has been shown to have positive benefits for people with chronic illness in terms of mood, fatigue, anxiety, and pain. And what it does is it teaches us to relate to this uncertainty in a different way, in a non-reactive, controlling way. The second point underneath the flexibility we're looking at here is having a raised consciousness and an expanded sense of self in life has been cited in the research as important. So seeing that we're more than our experiences, seeing that life is uncertain if we're real with ourselves. I feel like chronic illness just heightens that fact that healthy people are denying or have the privilege of denying for a good part of their lives that, you know, there will be endings, there will be limitations, there will be things we have to grieve and adapt to. And so working to really incorporate that into your overall outlook in life, and that doesn't have to be a bad thing. Additionally, in managing uncertainty is actually seeing that inconsistency becomes the consistency. So we can be certain, or we'll flip it on its head by saying we can be certain that there's going to be uncertainty. And, you know, in a way, this trick itself can kind of help us have a sense of calmness and groundedness. Actual practical actions that can be taken to help with this include journaling regarding symptoms and experiences. This can provide order, and as predictable patterns emerge, if you haven't done this, I highly recommend it. To journal, you know, maybe the end of each day or whatever, write down how are you feeling, how are your different symptoms and body parts at different times of the day in different situations. If you do this, you will see at least some patterns that you can then use to intervene and adjust to manipulate and have a greater sense of control amidst the uncertainty. And then generally planning for the inconsistency. So I think, you know, like with pacing is a big one. I know just personally for myself, if I know that I'm going to do something, I know that because my body can be inconsistent, that I will cushion maybe like a day or two before and after to prepare and recover, and knowing that there's going to be some kind of inconsistent failure at some point. And then another way that we can manage our uncertainty is to live for today, really. I mean, it's cliche, but it's true. The more that you can focus on just one crisis at a time, one difficulty. I think of there's kind of this old German, I believe it's either German or English, take care of the pound, or it would be English, take care of the pounds and the pence will take care of itself. So if you deal with just first things first and put psychological boundaries of not going to, you know, 5 years from now, next month or whatever, that can provide a relief from some overwhelm. So again, it can be really important to reclaim, because of uncertainty, a sense of control. And how do we do that? If we look at this midpoint here where it says increase self-efficacy and self-trust, this is a big one. In a study of individuals struggling with hypertension, researchers found that, quote, adherence could be enhanced by improving the patient's perception of controllability. What that means, medical terms, they have this concept of adherence, and that means how well do you follow your treatment plan and health regimens. And the more that you feel you have a sense of control, the more likely you are to make adaptations you need to reduce the impact of your symptoms. In the psychological literature, we have two terms here. We have self-efficacy and sense of coherence. So first one here, we have sense of coherence, which is our optimism plus controllability. So the more you can increase your sense of optimism and controllability, the better it will be for you, as well as your self-efficacy, which is one's confidence in one's ability to meet life's demands and act to make material differences in your life and your environment. So the more helpless and hopeless you feel, the harder time you're going to have adjusting, and the more it just becomes a cycle, the more anxiety you're going to have as well. So how do we build self-efficacy can be really important. That can include one thing that I do when I work with people is I have them make a list of all their achievements and accomplishments. That's a big one. Often when we face a new stress, we forget about all the really difficult things we've successfully faced thus far. And just by refocusing on that, that can create that stronger sense of confidence and ability. Putting yourself out there to take on one challenge at a time can facilitate confidence as you successfully manage each one, and thereby general self-efficacy are big things as well. Now, related to kind of taking it day by day and one thing at a time, I liked what one patient said in one study. He said, by open quote, taking life day by day, the faint feeling of loss and hope of what was can turn into a dropping of all the illusions that you had about yourself or the world, and getting to the point and generally recognizing that having an uneventful life, you can cope. So we're looking at reducing our stress, our general stress. And one thing I don't like about that is it does sound pretty kind of hopeless. I don't think that you have to give up everything, but you will have to give up some things. Some things we'll have to give up, some things we will get to keep, some things we will reclaim in new ways, and in some ways we'll just be completely new and different. So managing our expectations around that. So the research shows often related to, if I go back to self-efficacy here, often people feel more of a lack of control if these four things are present. So if you have a lack of education about your situation, that can create it. That can create the anxiety and feed into the uncertainty. If you have a lack of social support, that can as well. And if you have a lack of trusted healthcare providers, and if you have a lack of emotional outlet to express what you're going through, those four things can feed into anxiety for us and the general uncertainty and distress that comes with it. So it can be very important to address those things. For example, social support can be huge with chronic illness and uncertainty. The research shows, open quote, it facilitates information seeking. So we're back to that education part. Decreases avoidance behaviors and encourages reappraisal of uncertainty. Reappraisal meaning how we're thinking about uncertainty. What are the kind of thoughts we have around the uncertainty that we're experiencing? A great example of one study in 2008 of breast cancer survivors perceived social support, open quote, promoted better quality of life, whereas uncertainty diminished quality of life. Additionally, trust and confidence in healthcare professionals play significant roles in reducing uncertainty in persons with chronic illness. So consequently, if you're finding you're having a heightened sense of lack of controllability as you face your chronic illness, we can look at these four things and confidently say that there's probably one or more of them at work in your life that's, if not creating the anxiety, certainly exacerbating it. So we're looking here too in terms of at this final point here in reappraising uncertainty. So again, back to how do we think about uncertainty? One way we can do this is flip it on its head. Instead of uncertainty being bad, it can be good, because it means if we're not sure what's going to happen, and if we're not sure what's going to happen, good things can happen too. So that can be a way to kind of reframe and reappraise the situation. Additionally, related to reappraisal, we look at cognitive behavioral therapy. This is one of the most researched methods of therapy. It's highly effective across all kinds of problems, anxiety being a huge one. And what we're looking here is at types of cognitive appraisals. So the way that we're thinking about what's going on for us as we're an ill person. Now there's two types of these appraisals that go on for us mentally. We have first threat appraisals. This is really just clarifying, is this harmful? And if harmful, how harmful is this? This can be quite pronounced when you experience a new system, a symptom or an exacerbating symptom. You don't really know what it's leading to or what it represents. Is it just a fleeting symptom? Is it indicative of a bigger problem you're gonna have to face? Now at this point, when you're having these threat appraisals, your nervous system is going, like it is really keyed up. And so this can be a point of intervention in that maybe you redirect it. If it's a familiar symptom, you can tell yourself, you can remind yourself of that. No, I've coped with this before. I did X, Y, and Z that helped. How harmful is this? You know, use evidence, pull in, you know, I've had new symptoms before that weren't issues. This could be one of those times, you know, those kind of self-statements can help soften the anxiety and uncertainty. So those are threat appraisals. Now we have secondary appraisals. Now these are, once you've determined a threat is there, the secondary appraisal is assessing the controllability of the threat and the harm, and secondarily assessing one's strengths to access internal or external resources to meet the challenge. So how much control do I have here? You know, I'm experiencing, you know, symptom X. What can I do about it? What have I done in the past? Kind of going back to that thinking. As well as secondarily, what are my strengths and resources to meet this? You know, who can I call for emotional support or mobility aid or whatever it is? So these become the two, if you do cognitive therapy, we'd be first and foremost addressing two of these main kind of appraisals to help reduce anxiety. Similarly, if you look down here, if we look at perceived barriers to goal, life goals, this can be a cognitive process that can be difficult for people experiencing chronic illness. The more you see that what you're going through is going to interfere with what you had planned in life and what was important to you, the more anxious you're going to get. Additionally, we can see unfavorable social comparisons. You know, are you on Instagram comparing, you know, as you're lying in bed, you know, throwing up or whatever you're doing? Are you looking at, you know, your high school friend's trip to Africa or things of that nature and comparing your life? You're going to have a lot of anxiety and a lot of depression in doing those kinds of things. So cognitive therapy can be really helpful. For example, in one study of multiple rheumatoid arthritis studies, about half of the study showed a benefit from CBT. Additionally, CBT, cognitive behavioral therapy, has been shown to be to positively impact fatigue in ME and CFS patients, so reducing fatigue. As well as in fibromyalgia patients, it's shown to reduce what's called catastrophizing, so going to those worst case scenarios, which has resulted in decreased depression levels, pain, and improvements in self-efficacy. So it can become really important to keep our thinking in kind of a clean, ordered way that we don't spill out into some of this problematic thinking that just makes that a difficult time worse. Back to these threat and harm and loss appraisals, one researcher was noting that they were central predictors of later anxiety and depression in cardiac patients, to show you how real they are. If we go back to perceived barriers to life goals, they predict pain and fatigue in fibromyalgia patients. The more you're observing or telling yourself or believing your goals are thwarted. And then additionally, prostate cancer patients who accompanied or who met their illness by altering important life goals appear to be less negatively affected by physical dysfunction than men who do not. In addition, among rheumatoid arthritis patients, loss of value activity predicts depressive symptoms in the following year, mediated by unfavorable social comparisons and dissatisfactions with abilities, which is basically a psychological verbiage to say, you know, the more you compare yourself and the more that you're losing activities you value, you know, maybe not surprisingly, the more depressed you're going to be. So sense of control can predict distress, and it becomes paramount to access as much of a sense of control as we can. Self-efficacy, as previously indicated, our belief, again, that we can meet the distress and difficulties that are associated with chronic illness becomes paramount in the sense that in observing breast cancer patients before what they expected in terms of their self-efficacy, it predicted pain and fatigue after they had breast cancer surgery. So really, our thoughts and our mind do have a lot of power here. In terms of behavioral adjustments, so moving on from our thinking to what we really do, if you look underneath behavioral adjustments at the approach-oriented coping bullet point, open quote, approach-oriented or active coping strategies include information seeking, problem solving, seeking social support, actively attempting to identify benefit in one's experience, and creating outlets for emotional expression. So these all become paramount in terms of making behavioral adjustments. You're going to want to do all of these things as you face your chronic illness to reduce the suffering and improve your quality of life and well-being. In contrast to approach-oriented coping, avoidance-oriented coping involves thinking strategies such as denial and suppression, and behavioral strategies such as disengagement. Other coping efforts such as spiritual coping or potentially can potentially support approach or avoidance coping, and we'll talk more about that in our sixth presentation on spirituality, religion, and chronic illness. But generally speaking, approach or hinting coping is good. It means we're actively accepting what's going on, we're taking action to face it and adjust. Whereas avoidant coping, where we're in denial, we're hiding, we're suppressing, we're not communicating, expressing, or seeking information, that pretty much across the board predicts more negative outcomes for people who are chronically ill. Related to behavioral adjustments, and we alluded to this in coping with uncertainty in the last slide here with Buddhist psychology is mindfulness practice. A 2003 study showed that mindfulness over time resulted in decreased mood disturbance and stress for cancer patients. There's also other research that indicates it helps other groups and generally does help depression and anxiety. And then this last point on this slide is limiting or eliminating toxic relationship dynamics. The research shows that when you have relationships that include criticism, what's known as social constraint. Social constraint is that we're not able to fully express who we are and have it normalized and validated, as well as socialized isolation. will cause us problems while increasing, creating, and maintaining supportive relationship dynamics that are judgment-free, open to honest and direct communication, expression, and trusted and continued contact and support can have quite a significant benefit for those of us who are chronically ill. It can bolster adjustment, and whereas the other approach, the avoidance, is are robust predictors of what's called heightened distress, so increased problems. So generally speaking, there are positive outcomes if you can find your way through anxiety. There's evidence that people who cope with the anxiety related to chronic illness can have more positive reappraisal, meaning that their thoughts are more grounded, more supportive of well-being and optimism. Secondly, people can have what's called increased tolerance and appreciation for others. Greater self-acceptance can go with this as well. Perceived control mastery as well. So a sense of control over the disease and the related challenge. And finally, just generally increased optimism and joy in life. So there is a positive, there's a light at the end of the tunnel. If you do the work to actively address all these can be some of the outcomes that you experience according to the research. And just kind of as a final thought related to anxiety, there can be additional hope in terms of age, as research shows that older adults report more acceptance and with uncertainty. This can indicate that if you're chronically ill and younger, you may have more anxiety than those who are older and have chronic illness. Not always, but you may. And that over time, can naturally go down as you get kind of desensitized to the uncertainties of life. That'll be our presentation for now on anxiety. Here are some of the references if you are interested in diving deeper to any of the materials we talked about today. We will be happy for you to join us for the other parts of our series. The next third part, we are going to talk about depression with a brief overview about depression, chronic illness, and coping with it. We would welcome and love for you to join us then. Thanks for your time and attention.